know of my bear project that I've talked a lot about for a while. But my day job is running the museum here, so I run the overall museum and oversee the exhibitions. So it's been a busy year already between putting the bear exhibit together, the leather corner. We have a pre-World War I case that's mostly together. So this was the perfect opportunity, I think, to do a panel like this. I've been wanting to do something like this for the last few years to coincide with when IBR was. So it's a perfect opportunity with the exhibit. I'm gonna try to take a back seat because I never went to IBR. I moved to the city just as IBR was coming to an end. So for me, this is all history. I didn't live through any of the years, and really all I know is through the programming, through talking with these guys and others, and through all the videos and the photos I've seen. So I'll just briefly introduce the four guys, and we'll take it from there. So Larry here is the original San Francisco call bear. He's been in the city
since 76.
He's been a member of the Bears of SF. He's been a founding member, sat on the board, helped with IBR. Before that, he was the MC in Bear Rendezvous, all of them?
Bear Expo
92, 3, and 4?
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah.
He's in the exhibit emceeing Bear Expo 94 during the Skivvies part. I decided that was the best chunk of that contest to put in.
Who's the guy with the gray beard?
And he's currently vice president of the Bears of SF this
year. And quartermaster.
You have both jobs.
Eternally quartermaster.
Yeah, so he does a lot, I guess. Jason is also a founding member of BASF, and he served as secretary from 95 to 2001. And so when I got a lot of the Bears of SF records in 2013, I think it was Jason's organizational skills that made it super easy to put together, and they're a very extent, and I say that in a good way. I'd probably say a good third of what's in the exhibit was possible because of everything you saved and just the luck of cleaning out the locker the day.
I never let anybody throw anything out.
And I commend you for it. Paul joined the Bears of SF also in 94, but you were not a founding member. Okay. He joined a little after it was founded. He served on the board from 95 to 2004, and he was vice president from 2001 to 2004. Paul was the contestant coordinator for International Mr. Bear from 98 to the last year in 2011. I know he's in the IBR case. He has an award from 2007 or 8, something like that. In the case, too, for all the work he's done in the community.
When you finally got it off the board so that you give it to you.
Right.
Oh, yeah, that'd be a conflict of interest.
Exactly.
Yeah. And lastly is Mark Katzenberger at the end, who's been a part of the Bear Committee in BASF since the mid-90s.
Right.
And then from 2000, when he was a contestant, from 2000 when he was also a contestant as Mr. SF Bear.
Right.
Through 2004, he was a member of BASF board and was on the IBR steering committee. And I know, so Mark says this, but I'm sure most of you have done many different things during IBR, from helping, planning, executing, all of it.
However, I must say, once Paul got the contestant wrangler job,
which does fill up the whole weekend and much more before that. He just sort of honed in on that and...
It's because you wanted to see them backstage, right?
Exactly. Out of 700 plus attendees, those 20 were the only ones that had to talk to me. No one else had to, just those two.
I had to.
Only the last 5 years.
So I guess before we can talk about IBR itself from 95 to 2011, we have to back up to the early 90s with its predecessor, Bear Expo. And for that, I'm going to hand over to Larry, who helped the 3 years that that was running with MC and probably et cetera, et cetera, et cetera.
Mostly MC. The Bear Expo was sort of an outgrowth of these bear hug parties that were being held over on the house on 14th Street that everybody talks about.
And what were the bear hug parties?
Sex parties.
For those that didn't.
Well, yeah, for those, yeah. Yeah, it was a...
We hugged a lot.
Oh, yeah. A little hugging and screaming. And the Bill and Ben, who ran the bear hug parties, then had a magazine called Bear Facts, F-A-X, and then they got it in their head to have a bear gathering. And so they called it Bear Expo. And it was at the...
That was Fran's idea.
Oh, it was Fran's idea.
Yeah, the whole idea was Fran's.
Of course.
Yeah.
You should.
I'll just shout from back there.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, just head over.
You'll be a backseat panelist.
Yes.
So they took over the Holiday Inn on Van Ness, and at the same time as the Stamp people were there,
yes,
and they kept wandering into the wrong room with all the bear vendors, and oh, this isn't Stamps. And it was actually pretty successful. A lot of people. We filled up the ballroom.
Yeah.
And I forget why I was MC. Maybe I pushed myself to the front. I don't know. But
last man standing.
Yeah, last man standing. Anyway, they were successful. They were a lot of fun, and they were supposed to be for charity. And you actually can take that. The fact that the people who were supposed to receive the money said they didn't think they received enough, considering.
Well,
I'm gonna, yeah, go ahead.
Basically, the bear hug parties were a cash cow for Ben.
Yeah.
And he did not want to give that up. And we had a big dinner party. We were everybody that was the prime people that worked on the event. We had a big dinner. My partner at the time was Lurch, Mike Sutton. And we had a big dinner party at the house. We were all very nice and above board, but it came down to, okay, you either start giving more than what the sisters make for us to charity, and we'll keep doing it. Otherwise, no. And he said he wouldn't. So we said, okay, we quit. And we put on IBR and created Bears of San Francisco to do it.
That's basically
the
concept.
Yeah.
Mickey and Judy, let's put on our own.
Pretty much.
Well, it was very much the people who were involved or had been, you know, they had been through the AIDS crisis. They'd had all their friends die. They'd had all of that. It's like,
and
all these charitable
this
resources.
This was coming off of years of having 4 and 5 friends a week die.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
We had to do something.
The thought about doing something charitable was at the forefront of their minds. And so that's how BOSF and IBR came together, was we're going to use all this energy for, you know, the larger community, not just for one particular person.
No, I remember sitting in that living room. They call me a founding member, but I just happened to be in the living room when everybody else was talking about it.
Uh-huh.
And they were very careful not to step on any toes in case Bear Expo, the fourth Bear Expo, was going to happen. I remember we were talking about how to wait till the last minute, to do stuff. We had the tracks, no, what was the bar? Trucks.
Motorworks.
Motorworks, yeah.
Martinis is
there. Yeah, with Kern Martinis. And so that was like the one of the bars, and then we had the hotel on Market Street.
The Whitcomb. Used to be the Ramada. Yeah. And it just ended being the San Franciscan.
Yeah. And they, so there was an attempt, I guess, to revive Bear Expo. Somebody tried to do it, and it kind of didn't work, so we just threw ourselves into it, and...
He threatened to sue us. I mean, I got involved. I met Steve at a Bear Hug right that month when everything was coming to a head. So, of course, you know, Bear Hugs have to do with everything involving this. And I got sort of dragged into the whole thing. So I was there when we first started talking about IBR. And it was, okay, so they're charging $125 a person for this thing and giving them a dinner and... The other thing that comes out of it is a 50-50 raffle, and where is all this money going? So we decided to try to do it on a budget, to do everything that they had done at the previous event, have a dinner, have a contest, have all of these things, but only charge the symbolic price of $69. And, you know, we managed to... That year, give away $15,000. It was $10,000 in cash and $5,000 in services to three organizations. We were astonished by how much extra money we had, and we thought, wow, how much money did he pocket in those 3 years?
Oh, yeah.
At twice the price.
But the price of the weekend is what caused me to go to IBR, because
right.
I couldn't afford 100 and whatever.
125, yeah. Yeah,
I could barely afford 69, but
right. You may not afford it.
Eventually, yes.
Yeah. No, and the sort of the surprise of that. So the fundraising became really the core reason we were doing it, particularly at the beginning. It was all about. This all started because of Bear Magazine and Bear Facts and Bear Hug and, you know, all of our sexual attractions to bears as they were being defined. And don't ask me to define a bear. And then it was like, we can be a positive force for the entire gay community this way. The gay and lesbian community, the AIDS community, all of this, we can help people out. So it was... We defined it as we will split the proceeds amongst three charitable organizations. We will, you know, every extra dollar that's left short of some seed money for the following year, that's all going to go to charity because, you know, people are coming from around the world and trusting us with their money, and we should do something good with it. And so, starting out with $10,000 split amongst three, and then, you know, it kept increasing every year. Up until, you know, some economic crisis in 2000 or so.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So it was a great thing to be involved with.
One of the little things I found interesting was, I was looking at the records in 95, and I was really confused at first why certain people were trying to get a scholarship to go and how it was all working, but I think it was Larry, someone was telling me, one of you guys was telling me.
That's okay. Yeah, you can't tell us the part.
Even the steering committee, the board, everybody paid for their tickets.
Yeah.
So it wasn't, you're the president of BOSIF, so you just get to go and, you know, you have to be on the whole weekend, but it's free. No, you guys had put it
everybody
in.
Everybody is there on equal footing.
You guys paid as much as anyone else had.
Yeah, I mean, the perks were maybe getting one night free at the hotel as part of our package would think, but those would have just gone to waste anyway. The scholarship thing started, I think, the second year or whatever. It was David Dysart's idea. David Dysart was one of the great organizers.
One of the prime people behind it.
He came up with the whole contest idea.
Well, David came out of the leather world,
right.
And he wanted the IBR contest to be a takeoff on the leather contest.
I know. So, you know, it was done not as a hugely serious thing, but as a fundraising tool and as something a little tongue-in-cheek, and, you know, yeah, get these guys who are not encouraged to take their shirts off in public, to take their shirts off in public and then some, and to be proud of themselves, and to feel good about themselves, which so many of them had not before. So that was the other thing. Yeah, so the scholarship was to offset the registration fees for certain people who had, you know, medical conditions and fixed income and all of that who wouldn't otherwise be able to attend. We had to be very careful about that because of IRS regulations on how much can go to a person. So it ended up going away after a while.
And so for someone who had never really gone, I mean, I know the International Mr. Bear competition kind of was the culmination of the weekend, but what were the other things that happened during, I guess in general during the weekend? I know it changed year by year and certain things were added. Auction. Some people, you know, some events. Mm-hmm.
Dim sum breakfast on Sunday was always a big one. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we had a certain schedule of activities, and then you know, some things came in and left, and then there were optional things that people could pay extra to go do, like a teddy bear tour or, you know, the teddy bear factory.
Oh, right, I forgot
it. Yeah, you know, but again, it was really trying to pack as much as possible in for people's 69, then later 99, and I can't remember where we ended up, but in for that. Yeah,
good. No, agreed. Yes, other things we had, well, one of our, in the last years, not surprisingly, one of our most popular optional activities was Blue Bunnies. Go figure. Yeah, then of course I gotta have beer bus. There was also interestingly named online party, which in its first few years, it wasn't online. You know, such things go that didn't happen in it was about 97, I think, was the first year that Bob did it. But it was where you meet the people that you know online and put in, attach a face to, you know, whatever screen name, email name, or whatever they were using online.
Yeah.
So the Beach Blanket Babylon basically said, send them out, especially on Sundays, because we had to decorate the room and do interviews. Just send them out on buses away from the hotel.
Or at least give them the option to.
Yeah.
Those that weren't entertaining themselves at the hotel. Or shooting a porno, which happened more than once.
How often did we do the breakfast thing, the coffee? That was like a...
Oh, the Sunday brunch thing?
Was it just Sunday?
Well, we did that. We only did it on... Well, we had the hospitality suite the other days, but no formal breakfast. The brunch was also the setting for the silent auction for stuff, which was a good way to raise money. Because we would get, you know, vendors would donate things. Local businesses would donate things.
We had it during the live auction, too, a couple of years.
That's what I meant, the live auction. Silent auction is stuck in my head. We had a silent auction once.
Well, that's when you ran it, right? The silent auction.
Yeah.
The silent guy.
There was a silent auction. There was Celebrate San Francisco on Saturday night.
Albert King. Well,
for a few years.
Fran suggested this idea that let's celebrate San Francisco. Let's show people individual things that San Francisco has that nobody else does. And so Fran threw out this wonderful idea, and then Albert picked it up and ran with it and went around to food merchants who would actually come and set up little exhibits of their stuff or, you know, sort of uniquely San Francisco venues.
Right. And then we would dance around.
Huh?
Even Raymond Burr Winery.
Right. Oh, yes, Raymond Burr Winery. Right.
And that lasted until we decided to split the dinner and the contest.
Right.
Yeah.
That's right.
And then after that, we brought in Sister Bingo.
Sister Bingo, yes.
Which was, at the, you know, now it's become, you know, a common thing at bear runs, but at the time it was a little bit surprising to people. What are drag people doing at a bear event?
Right. No, and we had that several times with the entertainment of the contest, because
oh, yeah.
year two and year three we had Pussy Threat,
yeah.
Who knocked them dead, and they were people were like, oh, you want to go see my play? And then we had the Kinsey Six several times back when they were starting, and you know, it sort of changed people's attitude towards this thing, because the performers, the Kinsey Six, loved the Bears, you know, and it's like, we're not looking at you as these ugly, fat, hairy guys. You're our friends too, you know. So
they endeared themselves by wearing false mustaches on stage.
Exactly.
So the big thing then on the weekend was the International Mr. Bear competition. I know you all could speak about this. I'm not sure which one wants to take the lead.
Paul
should take the
lead.
Okay. Well, we have a contestant. Contestant coordinator, the judge coordinator.
And I just left it after that.
And you just left it
after. And original MC and substitute MC, the
hospital.
The first 2 years I attended, I just kind of helped out with David Dysart, who was the contestant coordinator for the first 3 years.
Easy everything.
And then I decided this is something I know I can do. I stepped up and did it for the rest of the time, 14 years. Most of all, 90% of the job was during the weekend, and it was one of the hardest jobs I had, but one of the most fun. Several people have said that it was kind of the penultimate bear contest, sort of along the lines of leather contest. But even though I inherited it that way, I never really saw it that way. I thought it was more, I tried to make it more fun for the contestants. The first year I did it solo, I had 29 contestants. And we had to narrow it down. So halfway through the competition on Sunday, we had an elimination round. And we did that down to 15 finalists, and we did that for almost six or seven years. Yeah. And Lurch and I kept trying to figure out how to get half of these people off stage without hurting their feelings, and it never worked. So finally, we all said 20 max. Then after a few more years, when we had trouble getting 20, and stopped it at 15.
Right.
And everybody went through.
Right. Yeah, but it was very much, it was then first come, first serve.
Right.
Right. The first 20 people who applied. Because people had to apply ahead of time to be a contestant, and they had to pay their registration. I mean, it was the same thing. Everybody's on the same equal foot.
Right. And so during the weekend, basically my job was to usher them through what they had to do. Orientation on Friday night, where I explained everything. Selling raffle tickets at the Eagle Friday night, at the Eagle Saturday afternoon, and then going through the interviews on Sunday morning, and walking through what we would be doing at the contest that night, and then getting through the contest.
And oftentimes, Saturday night, stopping in to take the shirts off during whatever Saturday night event was going on. Saturday in the middle of the day for dining room reservations or whatever. You know, basically, we worked the contestants straight through. You know, for 3 days, and Paul was there with them all along.
The mother duck, please.
And because it was so intense for them, I tried to make it fun. After the second year, I wasn't able to be there during the weekend because I got sick. So I was living in the Hague and 2 miles away, all these people were having fun. And I was lying there miserable. Anyway, I got a substitute for the weekend who is a leather person and ran it more like
a leather contest.
So, and pre-planning for the following year, one of the other club members, he got to the planning meeting a little late, so I had already said yes, but he got there and said, I'd like to do the contestants, and I said, I'd be glad for a hand. And so for 5 or 6 years, I had various assistants. But one of the things that John introduced that I think was one of the best things was a contestant mixer on Saturday afternoon before they went to the Eagle. Basically an hour at a local bar just for them and their partners. They weren't on, they weren't selling raffle tickets, just for them to relax and have a few drinks. Yeah.
And that also was when they would meet the judges. Because the initially, the contestants...
After the first one, we didn't... Right. It was the second year that I started that.
During the Friday night beer bust, when the contestants are selling raffle tickets, they don't know who the judges are. And the purpose of that was so the judges could really... evaluate, okay, how are they acting to strangers? If they don't know everybody's, who the judges are in the crowd, they sort of got to treat everybody good.
Yeah.
And also I should mention, with the contest, one of the inherent issues with having the contest is, okay, we've got a beauty contest for a subculture that many subcultures, eschews the standards of beauty, that are applied externally and not coming from internal. And the two are really somewhat opposed, in a lot of people's minds, and I had to sort of work through it myself, not the least when I was a contestant. But the important thing about the contest and the contestants was it was not on beauty. I mean, everybody likes seeing a good-looking guy take their shirt off. But the judging, it was overwhelmingly on the interviews, and the judging was all about how they presented themselves, strongly on community service, not on the more physical aspects attraction.
There was the private interview with the judges, and then how they comported themselves on stage. Whether they had questions from the judges then, or however else.
Originally, it was a one-minute speech, and throughout the first 12 years, Lurch and I, or one of the other MCs, tried to come up with a question that they could work on their speech throughout the weekend. It was usually like world peace type answer.
Yeah, it was.
And then Jason, who was the judge coordinator for the last 5 years, finally came up with an idea of asking them individual questions instead of having a prepared speech.
Right.
And that started like 2 or 3 years before the end.
So I think from the first time, I think I didn't want to do the speech thing, because the speech, after the...
Yeah.
After the eighth year of hearing the same speech thing 20 times in a contender, and you're just sort of like,
The first few of them, though, were still the more serious questions. The last year, we knew we weren't coming back. The whole, that was the best evening overall, no, everyone was laughing. All the contestants were just having so much fun. The questions that Jason asked were silly.
Yeah, most of them were silly.
And
is that my question? Even
is that my question? Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, because there was the whole interplay with the MC that year. And,
yeah.
But that's a whole different matter.
Finally, by the time we were finishing up, we got the contest right.
Well, yeah. As pointed out before, David Dysart's vision for it was this sort of tongue-in-cheek version of the IML thing, and a lot of people, understandably, started to take it very seriously. And so we still sort of had to keep it light while respecting their desire to have it taken very seriously. So it was this delicate balancing act. And by the end, it's like, well, we're not going to do this anymore, so I don't care what you think. We're and controversies and
there were many controversies. Yeah.
It's not that important.
Especially the year we had a film being made.
Oh God.
Oh, that one.
You weren't there.
I was there. I wasn't involved.
You weren't involved. What year was that?
I don't know. What
I want to say 2003.
You were president at the time.
Okay.
Three.
Oh, I think, okay, that's the one when Heath was judge.
I think that was probably three,
yeah.
It was about a certain movie person.
Yes, and it's, the film was essentially supposed to be about IBR and the contest, and what I didn't realize...
Oh, that was 2004.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. What I didn't realize at the time was that one of the directors was trying to make it more of a reality show by trying to stir up controversy.
It did not look good for certain people.
But ultimately it wound up being okay.
Right.
Because
after that year, one of the cameramen took over the direction of the film, and did it right.
Right.
And I have no idea if anyone ever got a copy of it
from
Nico or
I don't remember.
I do know.
I know Aaron.
In the beginning, Jim Alexander videoed the contest.
Oh, really?
This is where we have the first 4 years of it.
Right, but. This is just...
This was about the more behind the scenes and the whole process, not just the
contest.
And I remember we insisted on calling it a competition, not a contest, because it's no winners, everybody's a winner. not everybody got a ribbon just for participating.
Yeah. We do have one of our title holders here, J.D. Leggett, is Mr. International Dare 2010, and unfortunately didn't make it to 2011, but we had a video of him saying goodbye.
Yeah, part of the fun was always having the previous year's overall title winner step down and have their little speech and turn it over to the next one.
So, since J.D. can't really answer this tonight, I'll ask you guys. So, when someone wins International Mr. Bear, or Cub, or Grizzly, or Dad, or any of the titles, what do they do for the next year as a title holder?
Depends on the title.
Well, you specifically, if you could answer. But
one thing I want to say, I have a little bit of voices. There are many people who helped with IBR when I ran. I don't remember a lot, but I specifically remember these four men. And they made a big difference in my life. IBR 2010 made a huge difference in my life. And the four of you had a very big impact in my progression in the bear lifestyle. So they gave me the inspiration to raise money, to raise bear awareness, to raise the the lifestyle of a bear in the world that I live in now. And you have all had a very big impact on that. And I thank you for that. And because of you, I raised $80,000 in 1 year for gay homeless youth in New York City. You guys, without you, I wouldn't, before I ran for this title, I didn't know what a bear was till I won my Mr. New York title. They pushed me to run for this international bear title. And then when I got to San Francisco, I stepped back and I said, all of these other people said they've been running, they've been doing like things forever. And I said, I'm gonna step back and said, let them win their title. And these people recognized who I was. And they, even though I stepped back and said, I'm just gonna raise money, these people listened to me and recognized who I was. And I won my title because they listened to who I was. And it made me who I am today because people like these four men and my judges that gave me who I am.
You were a judge that year,
weren't
you?
No. No, the year I was, it was the year before.
Oh, okay.
2009.
Okay.
But I remember all four of you pushing me and telling me to be who I am. And I remember telling all four of you that I didn't know what a bear was, so I'm gonna step back and you said, then just be who you are and raise money for the charity that we're running and be who you are.
That's a very important part of it. I hadn't actually heard that before from you, but what a previous year there was a local contestant, Jim Gateau, who's not here tonight, who before the event was talking to me and said, I'm not sure I want to be in the IBR contest because I'm very shy. And I talked to him and I explained what the whole thing was about, and he did it, and it improved his self-confidence. Mm-hmm. And even though I haven't heard this from a lot of the contestants, I'm sure it happened a lot more than I know.
Yeah. No, and I remember talking to the judges the year that you were awarded, because they had gone through the interview and they were so impressed with your thoughts on what you wanted to do and what the issues were, and they said, this is a representative of what this big-hearted bear thing is about. Not just the looks, it's about the being, the way of being, and you fit that to a T.
Well, and I wasn't a judge that year, but I do remember after the winners were announced, you telling everybody that would listen, watch JD. He's the real deal, and of course we're always looking for the next generation.
Yeah. And with you, I won heels before Twitter came.
That's right.
I won my titles in heels before Twitter came. Because you all told me, be who you are and represent yourself, and you will be able to represent everybody else.
Thank you. So we got a little bit off of your question, although not far.
What a title holder
was expected to do. The first few years they were more expected to go out and raise money and represent the bear community. That kind of fell by the wayside after a while. We encouraged them to. Some did a lot better than others. Mm-hmm. There are some title holders that we never heard from ever again.
Yeah. I mean, it was expected that they would go out and be a good representative of Bears of San Francisco and of IBR, and sort of the ideals that we try to promote, but we didn't have any hold over them. And since they come back the next year, they still had to pay their own registration. They had to get there themselves. Yeah. I mean, we weren't subsidizing it. So, you know, it was a commitment, if they, as much of a commitment as they wanted to make it, and some did much more than others. I mean, some did much more than others.
I moved to San Francisco.
Yeah.
Because the inspiration you guys gave to me. Yeah. And I want to be part of the San Francisco community. Oh. Because of what you guys gave to me. And I will specifically say to Paul, you gave me a lot of inspiration to move here and be part of this community. And I thank you.
Thank you.
So, I guess, did you guys want to share any of your favorite stories of, I guess we'll do specifically, the contest? Competition, sorry. The
competition. Well, we all did that.
I have a favorite story. It wasn't part of the competition that I was involved in. I was standing backstage one year, must have been 2004, 3 or 4. And I'm waiting for the next thing, for my next cue, and all of a sudden I hear my name being called. Darwin was president at the time, so
would have been 5 or 6.
And apparently, my husband didn't know about it either, and he wasn't in the audience that night. But anyway, they called me out to give me a Tigger Bear Award. My online handle is Tigger Bear. And
because he's bouncy.
And they had found this stuffed Tigger doll in the locker and got a little wicker chair and made this little trophy out of this and just surprised the crap out of me.
Yeah.
Because at that point I was still on the board, I couldn't win the Spirit of Bear Award yet. But they wanted to recognize me for what I had done so far.
I remember when that came about, so it was 2006. And because that was the year I was first judge coordinator, so.
If I had been able to find the box that was in the garage, I'd probably for the exhibit as well. But
it was like, damn it, Paul, you're still on the board, so you can't get the award. Damn it, so we have to do something.
Go away.
Yeah. But they kept
hint, Larry.
Okay, we don't do it anymore.
No.
They kept it a secret from me by talking about it at a planning meeting that neither I or my husband were at.
My favorite story involves a plush something as well. This was 2004. We were working with the SF AIDS Foundation and asked that, hey, at the time they had the giant, the happy penis or the healthy penis promotion. So they had this giant pink plush penis with a great big smile on it.
Walking around.
Well, and so he was in the, you know, in the lobby that afternoon.
Of the Whitcomb Hotel.
Now, across the street from the Whitcomb Hotel is the Orpheum Theater, which at that point was showing Lion King. And there was a family that decided to eat in the restaurant before the show. And this little wide-eyed four-year-old comes out of the restaurant, sees this giant, smiling, plush, pink character, takes off races across the lobby to give the giant penis a big hug to the absolutely horrified expressions of the parents. Kid just says, hey, it's a big smiling pink thing. And then looks up and asks, where's Santa Claus?
Yeah.
So that was certainly, you know, after a few years, you think you've seen just about everything at IBR. Then you find no.
I don't think I have a favorite.
They were all favorites.
They were all favorites. the only one I can think of is for Bear Expo, the second or third. As the MC, I asked him to stage it. I've been doing this for all this time, and I haven't gotten laid at this event yet. And then they came up and asked me, and there were no offers even after.
And of course, one other great thing that happened during IBR was during 2004. You may recall in 2004, on Valentine's Day, our new mayor, Gavin Newsom, decided to start marrying gay people. And that was IBR weekend. And so all weekend long, I could look down, because we were, once again, at the Whitcomb, and the president got the nice suite, and had a nice view straight down to City Hall, and just see people all weekend long getting queuing up and getting married, and we didn't know how long it would last. Luckily, it kept on for a few weeks, but it was just the happiest, most wonderful thing, and people were just coming back to the hotel married, and I was able to sneak out about 20 minutes, got a couple of ceramic bears, and during our last Costco run, we got a big white cake. And the hotel actually put out some champagne and a table, and so we had an impromptu wedding cake there and in the lobby for all of the newly married bears.
Yeah, that was cool. Lots of favorite moments. I mean, one of my favorite things, especially when I was doing judge coordinator, was getting to escort each contestant one by one to their interview from the rehearsal space, and getting to be comforting to people and, saying, relax. But I think my favorite thing overall, well, two things. First was the year that we did a tribute to Lurch after he died, and also Ed Costa, who were both presidents, who died within days of each other. And they had both been essential parts of IBR, so it was really important to us that we recognize that. But a year earlier, the folks that put on Lazy Bear, Harry Litt, who I've known for years and years and years, and he was always a little skeptical about contests and the whole IBR thing. Skeptical is a nice way of putting it. because we do the same thing, and we don't have to have a contest or registration fees to raise money for charity. And it's like, that's great, but that's not what we're doing. We're doing something different. It's different. So finally then, his nephew?
Nephew.
his old friend was a contestant. So he got to see it a little bit differently finally, and he recognized that he had been unfair to us and got up and, Harry, 2005.
Which contestant?
Cody.
And so he got up and apologized for having been so tough on us, and really that really got to my heart, because it was one of those very frustrating things, because I adored Harry, and it was like there was this little thing in there that kept bothering me.
Was that the time he actually said "and even," and then he named somebody?
Yeah.
And we all just go,
So anyway, that was one.
Yeah,
I still want to fit.
Even as an MC, the last 2 years.
You had the year you subbed for Lurch. Didn't we have the video from the hospital room?
We actually all shouted.
We made a video,
to send to
that's
right.
The two times I did IBR, as MC, they were, Lurch had a heart attack the first time.
Yeah.
Yeah, and then the second one, he died.
Yeah.
Right. So they went, they had to go back to the well.
Larry works.
Dig down to the bottom to pick out Larry.
But I was very happy to do it, and those are real. I didn't even try and compete with him. I just put on my tuxedo and just as an MC, and then let the guy shine.
You were yourself.
Yeah.
Right.
Who else could I be?
So, IBR ends Monday or so, President's Day weekend. And then after, was IBR, I know the answer is yes, a year-long process of planning. But
10 months,
With BASA, that's the big thing the organization always did. Mm-hmm. And that's really where most of the resources went, per se, in the club.
We kept them separate, the finances separate, for the most part. When we would pick beneficiaries for monthly beer bus and stuff, it would be people who had applied for IBR, and we didn't quite, because we were narrowing it to three, and there were 20 groups that were, it's the same as contestants.
That was always an interesting process.
Yeah.
Jason was the beneficiary coordinator
a bunch of times.
A long time, and then I took over from him when he left the board. But just weeding through all these grant applications, getting together to discuss the various charities.
Right.
And it was fun being a part of that, because in May or June, when we did the check distribution, we'd get these people who come in and say, I was expecting a couple $100, or you're giving me $2,000, $3,000, $7,000.
Yeah. We can buy paper this month. Yeah. No, and we did actually sort of try to find the shoestring organizations.
Right.
And so organizations that don't, we wouldn't do the AIDS Foundation, for example, because that's just a drop in the bucket to everything else. But we did
Tenderloin Youth.
We did the Tenderloin AIDS Project. We did AIDS Legal Referral Panel. We did we did the transgender one.
There was a women's group in Berkeley.
We did
it was the Mardi Gras year. It was all.
It was all New Orleans.
New Orleans,
yes.
Right. Yeah. We always did a national, an international, and a local.
Right. Two locals and a national.
National. Yeah.
Because we wanted to reflect that what we were doing was raising money for both the local groups where most of our attendees were coming from and those who were from far away. So it's not like, your dollars are just going to, local charities. It's like, spread it out more.
Does anybody want to talk about celebrities?
Celebrities?
Because we have one or two.
Mm-hmm. Do we have to?
No.
I got stoned with Kevin Smith.
Oh.
It changed my life.
Just how many things changed your life?
Because right after, he got on a plane and got kicked off because
he was too
weren't big enough.
Because
right.
Right.
Yeah. He was too stoned to realize,
right.
I could just...
Right. Okay, there was a celebrity little
one thing.
Yeah.
And having Kathy
Griffin.
I guess it's the two. At the Castro Theater, I think really did well for beneficiaries that year.
Oh, it was huge. I mean, it was a huge risk, and it paid off, but it also set this the bar too high, and because there's no way we could do that again. I mean,
in a way, that event kind of seemed to be the from then on, it kind of went downhill.
Well, I think that was just coincidental. I mean,
Well, yeah, okay. There were
other factors. I mean, there were economic issues. There were lack of interest. I mean, I know that, well, back in the 90s when we started, there were bear events all over the place, but, you know, mostly big cities and coastal. And then in the middle of the country, they started to have more, so people didn't have to travel all the way to the coast to do one of these things. And so the coastal ones were the first ones to sort of fall away.
And then also we had the competition with other local events going
that
on
was the, yeah,
that were trying to cashing in on the fact that all these people were coming to town.
Right.
Yes, all the dances and whatnot.
And
whatnot. Which is why the last couple of years we got at least one of them to come to the hotel.
Right. But by then it was like, you know, there wasn't enough local support anymore. The costs were about to go up astronomically again for us. The last year we didn't raise enough money to meet our hotel commitment, so we, you know, a lot of money went to the hotel rather than the charities. So it was just, we can't do this anymore.
Yeah.
It's way too much work for not a lot of yield. So.
Which was another reason why we went all out on the...
Oh, the last one. Oh, yeah, it was totally, totally... we're going to make this a fond memory for people. Not, yeah. Yeah. So, yeah, it would end us on Monday. We'd have the go-home party at the Lone Star, which was basically, if you're still around, come by, but then go home already. Yeah. And then, you know, we'd die for a couple weeks afterwards.
And about Easter Eve.
Yeah.
Next year,
we'd start talking about it in May, probably, and start seriously planning by July.
Yeah.
After the first 2 years, I mean, there was a good framework in place, and, you know, there was the whole institutional memory that kept, okay, we already know how to do this, we know these are the groups, these are the people, the merchants we need to contact, these are, you know, the people we want to get involved, this should happen by October 1st, things like that. So it was... It didn't run itself by any means, but
you had it.
We didn't have to figure it out again. So it became easier.
What's amazing to me still is that people think every bear event in California is our because of the bears in San Francisco. I mean, is that your, is the river your thing?
Oh yeah, that was the other thing, the lazy bear. No, that's not us. Mm-hmm.
There were a couple people, in fact, Vito from LA, told me that he based their competition on the way I ran ours. So, yeah, there were probably things that people took away and tried to incorporate into their own event.
Sure.
But...
And we stole from
it. And we stole from it. I mean,
yeah.
Before we opened, but the very first, I mean, Lurch and Steve and I and several other people were at Bear Bust in Orlando right as we were starting to plan this, and we, you know, sort of took notes on what was going on, what worked, what would only work there, what we could adapt. And then we saw the Chicago people at the first IBR writing down notes doing it, and it's like, that's great. I mean, I saw my own legal language of, you know, I agree to hold Bears of San Francisco not responsible, the waiver thing, and it's like, I began to see that on everybody else's exact same language. It's like, great, please, I'm not a lawyer.
One of the other fun things about the weekend was Sunday night, after the competition, hanging out in the hospitality suite with this one.
Or in the hall,
anywhere, just hanging out and bitching about everything that happened.
Well, out of your shop of the attendees.
Yeah.
And the contestants especially.
Sometimes they were bitching to us as well. So, but just,
It was
the decompression, the Sunday night decompression.
Let it taking your girdle off.
Essentially, yes.
Do they have questions?
Yeah, I'd say, I guess we can open it up before I ask my...
Oh, no,
I was just going to ask about the ending of IBR. So I guess we'll see if there's any
audience questions before I ask about how it ends.
They can't wait to hear it.
Well, the thing is that I, you know, most of the people here I know from
right.
my yard, and it's like,
yeah.
What did you learn tonight? Yeah, yeah,
yeah. Right, there, I'm sure there's some details that I'm not.
There
I don't know
details
that I have to read between, but I'm sure you guys know exactly.
Like Jason said, out of earshot of the attendees and the contestants.
Yeah. No arguments in front of, you know, take it.
And there are some things that spilled over a little bit. The four of us know that we'll never tell.
Well, I won't tell them because I don't remember them.
the longer we go, the more the rest of us will, too.
Yeah, the less we remember.
Yeah, period.
So 2011 is the last year, and I do remember Bossup's website had a laundry list of reasons why it ended, and you know, it's you can never say there was one reason. I mean, I know with Harry's stroke and Lazy Bear in 2010, that hampered a little bit, but then, you know, no.
Yeah.
That was
it was a completely independent thing. I don't remember the laundry list, even though I wrote most of it.
You were the PR person on that.
No, I composed it, let's put it that way, based on input I got from everybody. But it was, you know, the cost of the venue,
mm-hmm.
the declining attendance, the fact that people weren't staying at the hotel, which raised our costs enormously.
And they wanted us to sign a two-year contract.
They wanted us to sign a two-year contract, and we weren't going to do that, so we'd have to go hotel shopping again. And, you know, not enough money for charity, too much work for not a lot of you.
Right.
Basically it was difficulty with the hotel. The cost for the hotel kept on going up. You know, San Francisco hotels aren't cheap. You know, fortunately, in our early years at the Ramada, the Wyndham, they needed us a lot more than we needed them.
Right.
And also we had a really good hotel guy write the contract and negotiate with them. It worked out well for us economically, but once that went away, that was a huge risk.
Yeah, and also we had, David Dysart had friends who were in various tech things for the contest, of the lighting, the sound, all of that, that we got donated, and then eventually we had to start paying for it.
You can't put enough emphasis on how important David Dysart was to IBR. Because every technical thing, he searched the hotels for the hotel to use.
And then what happened with the Ramada was, we came in, we were like one of their first legit events after a lot of, it had been kind of trashed, and they had just remodeled the place when we went in to talk to them about renting it. Way back in like August of 94. So we put them on the map in many ways, and they remembered that because it was the same management the whole time. And so they kept, you know, being very accommodating to us. It was just when we completely outgrew them. And some of our attendees had trouble with maintenance issues, but, you know, it's a 100-year-old building. What are you going to do?
Another problem.
Yeah, I'm sure that IBR cough was from the hotel mold and not who you were making out of.
Right. No, that has to do with it at all.
Another problem towards the end was the volunteer burnout.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I mean, I think I did contestant coordinator for 14 years, and I was a volunteer for another two in addition. So I worked 15 or 16 out of the 17 years of IBR. Jason worked maybe 10.
Seven and five, 12.
12. Mark worked a lot. Larry worked all of them.
He was a volunteer for everything.
And then all of the other volunteers, just getting people to do stuff. Now, I remember the year Bob was president, he was talking about getting volunteers, and his big thing was, if you don't want to volunteer
for 2 hours because you're afraid you won't get laid. You're not going to get laid in those 2 hours anyway. So, but by the end, the same people were doing
the same things
year after year, and it took a toll. As much as I love doing the contestant thing, by the end I was glad to have that weekend off.
Yeah.
And not just the weekend, all the time leading up to it, about everything that it takes to put
it on. Yeah, the last 5 years, this particular Thursday night, I would have been, going absolutely insane.
Yeah.
And for the last 5 years, it's like I still get this little twitch around this time.
It was so nice getting Christmas back.
Not to mention January.
Yeah.
The reason I'm here tonight is because I got the opportunity to let you guys know that you guys made such a difference in my life. So all the hard work and everything that's aggravating and irritating, I want you to know that you guys really made, you guys changed my life. I live here. I just got married last week. I live here. I'm experiencing the San Francisco experience because of what IBR gave to me. And that's why I'm here tonight, to make sure that you guys know that, yes, you have to volunteers, et cetera, et cetera. But all the work that you guys did made me who I am right now. And I thank you.
Thank you.
All for that.
I have one other favorite thing. I just remember. Middle period at some point, Lenny Broberg did our auction, led our auction. A couple that we knew from Iowa, and there was the older guy and then this really young farm boy who really didn't know a whole lot of things. And Lenny talked very freely about being a gay cop. And being, having all this and having been IML and being a community activist, but also being a police officer. And afterwards, this kid went up to him and said, "You're a police officer." "Yeah." "No, you're really a police officer." "Yes." "Really?" "And you're gay?" "Yes." "Really? Wow." It was like, it never occurred to him that could happen. It was like this kid's world just opened up. It's a very similar sort of thing, much smaller scale. But, he said, "Wow, I guess I could be anything." Well, he couldn't, but. Well, he's a dear, sweet boy, but.
I hope he doesn't watch this.
Thank you guys for all that advice, sharing all these stories, man. It was very interesting to hear about. And obviously, there was like huge passion and commitment. And I've been involved in other subcultures that were doing similar kind of work and also experienced some of the same kind of challenges around continuing things year after year. I'm thinking especially of the sobriety community and the Living Sober Conference every year. And also AIDS work, of course, and all these things kind of intersect, and we have overlapping communities and everything. But I'm wondering, this kind of work and these kind of meetings and conferences and runs and hugs and everything, it builds community, and friendships and prides or whatever you call it. And
sleuths.
Sleuths? Okay.
Sleuths of
it. All right. So it ends. The rendezvous ends. Where does the bear community stand now? Does it continue to thrive and grow? Are young people coming into it now?
It's online.
It's online.
Yeah. I mean, that was starting to happen, but now it's all on an app.
The club does still exist. Bears of San Francisco does still exist. We're all members. Larry's still on the board. My husband was vice president for the last few years.
President.
President.
Sorry. That's right.
Yes.
You were first lady.
Yes. He was very proud of the fact that we had our first black president of the U.S. and the first black president of Boston.
Yes.
But so the club is still going. It's not as strong as it was during the IBR years, but we do still have beer busts. And actually, now that the Lone Star is owned by Bears again, they will be more frequent, more once a month rather than once a quarter,
right,
at the Eagle. We have Bear dinners, dinner nights. Our annual trek to the House of Prime Rib is in January.
Very vegetarian friendly.
Yeah, sorry. But so there's still things going on, and but again, like Jason said, a lot of the Bear community is more online these days.
And there, you know, and there still are, of course, beer rooms. You know, TBRU, Texas Beer Roundup in Dallas, gets bigger every year. You know, but generally, they're in the midsection where people drive to them. Kentucky just finished theirs.
Right. Yeah, Tucson still has theirs. Mm-hmm. Chicago has the benefit of being the same weekend as IML, so there are people there already anyway.
The one year I experienced in Chicago, when I actually went to Chicago for a gay and lesbian square dance convention, which was at the same hotel, host hotel, as the IML, and the Bear thing was around the corner, and the crossover between any two of them was about 25%, and then 25% of that was all three. It was just, an amazing week.
Right. I mean, those places all have lower hotel costs, for example. Right. They have more room to move around. Yeah. People can get there, again, they can drive.
The Echo of IBR for the current, you know, there was a San Francisco, is that we still give away money, mm-hmm. and we have almost the same beneficiary process. We, instead of having this one giant fundraiser, we do things during the year and have a check distribution, which we did have last Saturday, for the organizations that we choose.
Yeah.
So that's what's that?
This place happened to be one of them.
Oh yeah.
Oh, that has nothing to do with the screen view, right?
No.
Or the exhibit.
No, it was just all coincidental. So we're smaller. We're trying to work out ways to get younger people involved.
Every group I've been to is trying to find ways to get younger people involved.
Yeah. I guess maybe have to kidnap.
That sort of thing is just changing. I mean, that's what's happening.
One of the fallouts from an event, a phenomenon like IBR, is the friendships. Yeah. Even though I don't see people, I haven't seen Jason in at least a year. I don't know. But
we were here a few weeks ago.
No. Before that, sorry. Okay. Forget the people in this room.
There are people who
are here. There are people that I met years ago at IBR that I still, I don't converse with them every day or even every week, but every so often you find yourself.
It's one of the reasons I have 900 Facebook friends.
Exactly.
And it's like, wait, I actually have met all of these people, except for that one. But, you know, that's because I want to meet that one.
And then with the contestants, that's even, I think, even more for me and Jason, because we were the ones
especially
who
had to deal with it. Yeah, it's a very emotional and intense period for the contestants, and so you know, here's this imprinting again, the mother duck. You got imprinted on. Yeah. Do you walk behind him all the time?
But I will tell you, I'm still in touch with about 90% of the people that I competed with.
Yeah, no, and I've heard that about other groups too. Yeah. It's very nice. I think one of the things that I'm proudest about with IVR, because of all the money we gave away and the way we raised visibility for our community, is that anytime you see now a gay pride parade, the bear contingent usually gets the loudest round of applause. I remember when we did the parade several times, it was like, wow, they like us. and it's like, we were sort of invisible for a while, and now we're not. And you know, I saw one in London, and it was the same sort of thing. I mean, the bears were being silly.
Yeah.
And still masculine, and yeah, you know, and all of that stuff. And it's like,
we didn't work out for 3 months to ride that parade.
That's for sure. That's for sure.
We are who we are.
Right. We didn't go to the waxing salon.
We are who we are at that parade.
That
when we're at the parade, then that's who we are.
Okay. I mean, in the exhibit, there's a clip from, I think it's the 2005 Pride Parade, and whomever the woman is interviewing Darwin is saying, oh, I mean, you know, the gays in the media, you have your, you know, your GQ type models, this and that. I don't think there's any back here. You know, but she asks him, do you aspire to be like those guys? He's like, oh, hell no. I think I forget who it is, but on the float or the truck that was turned into a float, you have this big old drag queen in the bear color.
Tish.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, it looked fun, and I don't know what else thoughts to say that, but it was a fun float.
Yeah. Yeah, I like to think that we try to accept as many different people as possible. I mean, we fail at, every attempt fails, but, you know, you're making the effort, and you know, that's been my thing.
Any more questions, comments, stories from IVR to share?
Too many. What time do you close?
When are you kicking us out?
You have till 9.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Touch on was Fran himself and the art that Frank Frisch did for both the Bears of SF as an organization and International Monday. The exhibit behind me is based on Frank's work and his contributions to the community, in addition to kind of a narrative about the community. And it was an easy concept. Fran's work was threaded through everything. He did all of the graphics for Bears Best Sap. He did all the graphics for International Bear Rendezvous. So that was an easy way to put this together. And Fran's work is really the thread that, in my opinion, the thread that runs through the whole community and through International Bear Rendezvous. So, Fran's work really is integral to the stories we were talking about tonight and the bear community in general in the city. Thanks.